This is Yellowwood. It's a species which is performing well in Minnesota. It is a legume, and so it does pretty well in gravelly and sandy sites. It also transfers and moves well as a bare root, and it has lovely yellow fall foliage. So this is a great tree to try out in southeastern Minnesota.
Hey, Monica showed you a yellowwood growing in the light shade, a younger one that we've recently planted. This one has been in the field. This is full sun, and it's been here a bit longer too. And as you can see, it's doing really, really well.
Here we are, again on the east side of Lake Nokomis, and at the Oak Point Arboretum is one of the names for this part of the park. And this is a yellowwood, and yellowwood is another tree that's been in our sort of trial, you know, kind of experimental list that we've been subscribing to in greater numbers recently. Last year we planted a lot as a result of not being able to get as many cork trees, and we had a big large group that we needed to find something else for, and we're like, hey, I bet we could find some yellowwood, so let's give that a bigger shot. And so we've been planting yellowwood in our parks and in the street tree population quite a bit to just see how it's going to do. So I wouldn't say we have results of that yet, but we have seen successful yellowwoods in a variety of places, this being one of them. This one's probably maybe about 20 years old, planted as part of a previous Arbor Day. And we have also, we've seen one in downtown, which is kind of interesting. That's been actually, it's a small little row of them in downtown in North Loop that's doing quite well. And so we're optimistic. We have it in multiple locations, so we'll keep an eye out and see how it does, but we'll be trying it. It's pretty cool. It has really nice smooth bark and a compound leaf. And so it's this tree specifically, I was riding around the path and came across this tree and was kind of floored in the spring. It was covered in bees, and so really great pollinator friendly plant to bring in any insect looking for pollen and or flower lovers in general. It was just a trip to see some of the biggest bumblebees I've ever seen.
Here we're visiting the lovely tulip poplar. This is a great tree which is performing pretty well in southeastern Minnesota. It has even begun to naturalize at the University of Minnesota Landscape Arboretum. And it has these very cool leaves which look either like dinosaur feet or like t-shirts, depending on your perspective and imagination. The tree has a very natural upright form. They grow very straight, so they're valuable lumber trees throughout the southeast. They have very showy and fragrant flowers, which are not commonly seen in Minnesota, but could happen. The tulip poplar also grows well in both light shade and full sun, so it can be a pretty adaptable tree. Next, we're going to look at another lovely tree which is doing well in Minnesota. Here we're standing at a Chinese catalpa. This has many of the same qualities as the native northern catalpa, but it has a few different features. It does well in tough sites, similar to northern catalpa, so it can grow in really gravelly and tough soil. It's a little bit smaller than northern catalpa, and it also has smaller and daintier flowers and beans.
Great. We are at Osage Orange. It's also called hedge apple tree. Monica likes to call it Osage Orange.
I do not.
But it's one of those trees that we've had high hopes for, but it's not quite ready for prime time. Every year it dies back to the ground. Every year it grows back up 6 to 8 feet tall. It's always going to stay a small tree. It does get a fruit. Does have thorns, however there's one variety, and I can't remember the name of it, that is thornless, and it's a male variety, But if you want to stop people from cutting through an area, this is the tree to plant. It's very, very tolerant of hot, dry soils, and that's why we're excited about it. But I would say probably within a decade, it's going to be doing really well for the whole southern part of Minnesota.
Here we're at Don Redwood, or Meta Sequoia. It is a tree which is doing fairly well in Minnesota, and it's a good deciduous conifer alternative to bald cypress, which is not performing as well in Minnesota. This is a really interesting tree. It's the sole species within its genus, and it's a very old species.
All right, here's one I bet you haven't heard much about. This is Cornelian cherry dogwood. It is a true dogwood. It does very, very well in southern Minnesota, at least in southern Minnesota. Stays small. It'll get up, maybe a little bit more than twice of its height right now. So why are we recommending it other than it's dogwood and it does well here and it stays small? In the spring, it flowers before forsythia and just brilliantly beautiful yellow flowers. It's just covered with the flowers. And normally it'll have a fruit, and it looks kind of a combination between a cherry and an olive. It's got a little bit of an oval shape to it. Absolutely delicious. And if you're looking at this wondering why there's no fruit on it, remember that cold snap we had this spring? Well, that occurred right when this thing was in full bloom. So it did flower, but there was no successful fertilization and formation of fruit. But hold on, it's going to be a really good one for Minnesota. Cornelian cherry dogwood.
Here we're visiting the Manchurian ash, which is a great alternative to native ash trees, as this tree is native to northeastern Asia, in the same area that emerald ash borer comes from. It has a very dense and oval shaped crown. It does require frequent pruning in early years because it is prone to co-dominant leaders in urban landscapes. And it has similar leaf features as, or leaf characteristics as, black ash.
I thought I would share a couple thoughts on Manchurian ash. We had some that were part of an arboretum collection at Lindale Park near Lake Harriet. We've been watching them and not purposefully not removing them as part of our systematic replacement of ash trees as part of our ash canopy replacement plan, because of the suspicion that they have resistance to emerald ash borer. And unfortunately, as pest pressure continued to mount in that area, we eventually did see them decline and saw evidence of emerald ash borer in them, and one completely died and the other was very much in decline, and with, you know, the S-shaped galleries and exit holes, and so it was a kind of a bummer to see them go down so hard to emerald ash borer and probably other causes, but it definitely seemed like an emerald ash borer infestation. So I'm curious to see, you know, there are a couple newly planted Manchurian ash that are hiding out in the Minneapolis urban forest, and curious to see how those are gonna do as really small trees establishing, if it'll be any different story from the mature trees that we lost a few years ago. We'll see.
All right, now we're at the hardy rubber tree. We have several of them that we've planted that are smaller than this. It's been surviving really well for us in southern Minnesota. It looks a lot like an elm tree, and a lot of people mistake it for an elm tree, but it's not. The reason why we're keen on this tree is it's heat tolerant and it's drought tolerant. And you all know John Ball at South Dakota State, and this is one of the five trees that he said are the premier trees for South Dakota. So we've had nothing but good luck with it, and I think it has a bright future here in at least the southern part, southern third of Minnesota.
Here I am on the east side of Lake Nokomis, and we're among one of our groups of plane trees, London plane trees. And these were planted a while ago. You can see some of them, one of them behind me, and we'll look at some more in more detail. This is a tree that, you know, we had noticed some mature ones in the forest, really large ones, in certain parts of the city, and we kind of wondered, hey, we should be giving that more of a shot. And so, you know, 5 years ago or so, we started ramping up our trials of them, and some of them started to do really well. And so we've been using it more and more. Became one of our a bit often used to a degree for a few years, and then we had a really cold spell and saw a lot die back that were established, and we sort of got into utilized our research partnership with the University of Minnesota, and with the help of research started trying to and a lot of data collection, trying to figure out, okay, what trends are there, which ones made it, which ones didn't, which sites are better, which sites are worse, and that analysis continues. At the initial, after data collection, we had figured out there was about 40% did okay after a really harsh winter. This study's not complete, so we'll keep learning more. We didn't see initially, as I recall, a difference in cultivar between Bloodgood and Exclamation. They both were equally challenged by the conditions of that harsh winter. So the verdict's still out and analysis continues, but I want to show you some of our newly planted, smaller than these examples. There's one on the other side of the camera I'll show you that where the tree died back from the top, but it's still growing. We'll see if it recovers. And then there's one not too far from the park over here that's gigantic in a yard. And so it's an interesting one that we're hoping to figure out what the recipe is for getting a new genera in the urban forest. I guess not new, but a rarely used genera as a more established tree, and try to figure out what's that recipe? What's the trick? Maybe we can learn that together with our research partnership.
Now we're looking at Frontier Elm. This is actually one of my favorite elms, and it's doing very, very well in southern Minnesota. What's so great about it? Stays small. At maturity, it'll get up around 20, 25 feet. It's got good resistance to Dutch elm disease. And best of all, in the autumn, the foliage turns red. You can see a little bit of the reddish color on this, but it's a nice dark burgundy red in the autumn. So it gives us another option rather than just maples for a red autumn foliage. Easy to plant, transplant, bare rooted, should be used more. All right, we're looking at a larch. Not very good looking larch tree, is it? See how brown it is? This is not dying. This is not autumn. This is Japanese beetle damage. But what's really interesting, this happens quite a few years now in a row. And this is a Japanese larch. So we have four different larches that grow in Minnesota. Perfectly cold hardy. Japanese beetles love it. But I want to show you something really cool. Follow me. All right, look at this larch. Do you see any Japanese beetle damage to it? No. We are less than, we're about 100 feet away from the two Japanese larches that were pretty much nailed by a Japanese beetle. So why is this one so healthy? Is it because it's sprayed? Nope. Is it because the wind blows in a different direction? Nope. It's because it's an American larch. This is our native tamarack, and the Japanese beetles completely ignore it. So, if you're having problems with Japanese beetles and you want to plant a tree that they pretty much leave alone, plant the American larch.
Here we're hanging out with the Katsura tree, which is a species native to Japan and China, and it is one of only two species in its genus. So it has very few pests and diseases. It is a small to medium-sized tree, so it's good for smaller-sized yards. And it prefers moist soil, so it does not tolerate drought or crummy soil well.
Hey Ryan, what's the definition of insanity again?
Doing something thinking you're gonna have a different outcome.
Doing something over and over thinking there's gonna be a different outcome. Okay, once again this year I'm trying to grow Zelkova, And I have about 40 zelkovas in the gravel bed, and I can pretty much tell you what's gonna happen with them. They're gonna be beautiful. They're gonna just produce wicked thick root systems. And then look how nice they look too. And then this autumn I'll plant them out, and then next spring when I come back to look at them, and there they are in the field, gone, because they're dead. We have had terrible luck trying to get zelkovas to survive in Minnesota so far, so they're not quite ready for prime time yet. Come on, climate change.
Here we're standing at a bald cypress, which is a marginally hardy species. We talked about it earlier when we were visiting the Dawn Redwood. This often doesn't perform well in Minnesota. It will die back from harsh winters. This is an example of a specimen which has done really well, likely because it's in a super protected area. So this one has had a better chance at getting going in Minnesota. So if you're interested in planting bald cypress, try and plant it somewhere where it'll be super protected and the microclimate might be a little bit warmer.
We are here at Lake Nokomis Park, and we're in an area to the west of the lake that routinely floods. We're amongst an interesting group of trees here, are some bald cypress. We had one that was planted here a while back, and because of its success, we've continued to plant some, and sometimes they make it and sometimes they don't. You know, it'll grow for a while and then it kind of shrinks, and then it grows for a while and then it shrinks, but some of them seem to do pretty well. There's one back behind me here that even has some really cool cones. It'd be fun to take a closer look at those. But bald cypress in the urban forest in Minneapolis, it's on one of the, I would categorize it as on our highly experimental list. You know, we keep trying it, we're hoping for it. We have some spots that it succeeds, but those are few and far between. When trees in this category for us, we'll mostly be trying it in park locations. If we're trying it in a street tree location, it's in a street tree location that's not, you know, in front of a business or home. Maybe it's on the edge of a park or the edge of a property that's less going to less scrutinize that planting. And we have had some that have succeeded out of that, but it's a rarity. But it's pretty cool when they do work out for the patient site.
All right, here we are, Beijing Gold. Get excited, Beijing Gold tree lilac, and this is a Peking tree lilac, not a Japanese tree lilac. So why would you switch over to this one? It's just as hardy. Still does well in de-icing salt sites. Still has a really pretty flower, except this one is kind of a pale yellow flower, so it gives it a little bit more variety. It's an early summer flower. As it matures, it has kind of a nice coppery looking bark on it too. So it's got a little bit better looking bark than tree lilac, and it's been around for quite a while, and it's not invasive. So it's a good one for us to use when you're looking for a small tree that's not going to get any taller than maybe 15 or 20 feet. That's it.